First, I would like to attempt to organize it for this invitation. It is a big honor for me to give a talk at this seminar. There is a beautiful seminar, a beautiful idea. And I must apologize because I talked not about recent results, and some people who could listen to me before could listen my talk on this subject. Yes, I hope that in the near future I'll prepare this paper for publication. Okay. So I'll talk about the problem of Hardy and Littlewood. They had a conjecture that for any integers x and y greater than or equal to 2, we have this inequality. As usual, pi of x is the number of primes up to x. And it is easy to check that this inequality holds if x and or y. X is smaller, y is small. And it has been verified for minimum of x and y up to this guy, 1371. It was done by Gordon and Radomich in 1998. But Hensley and Richards showed that this conjecture is not compatible with the prime k-tuple conjecture. Now, I recall what does it mean, and actually we need the prime k-tuple conjecture in some particular case. So we have the following conjecture. So first, let me give you a definition. As a set of integers is admissible if for any prime p this set misses at least one congruence class modulo p. And the prime k-tuple conjecture says that for any admissible sequence B1 and set BK, there exists infinitely many integers and such that all numbers n plus B1, etc., n plus BK are primes. So actually, it is related to the equation what condition do we need for a finite number of a finite set of integers B1, etc., BK, such that there are infinitely many n, such that n plus BB1, n plus BK are primes. Of course, we can have local obstacles. What are the local obstacles? If for some prime P, for any n, one of these numbers is divisible by P, then of course, we can't have a large n such that all these guys are primes. And to avoid it, we require that this sequence is admissible if it is admissible, then we don't have any local obstacles. So for any p, there is n such that all these numbers are not divisible by p. And the conjecture says that if there are no local obstacles, then we can expect that for infinite integers m, all these numbers are primes. Okay, and we use the following notation, rho star of x. It is the maximum number of integers in the interval y from y to y plus x, excluding y and including y plus x. And you see that this interval contains exactly x integers. And this guy is the max number of integers in this interval, which are relatively prime to all positive integers up to x. Yes, it is easy to see that if y is greater than or equal to x, then we have this inequality because pi of x plus y minus pi of y is just a number of primes in this interval, and if a number from this interval is a prime, then it must be related to a prime to opposite integers up to x. And there is a simple relation between this quantity rho star of x and the admissible sequence. So if you have some admissible sequence belonging to the big case such that the difference between the largest and the smallest integers from the sequence is less than x, then by the Chinese remainder theorem, we can translate this sequence such that after the translation, all numbers will be relatively prime to p, for any prime p, for any prime yes, for any prime p up to x, we can do it. Okay, and if you have such translation that all translated numbers are relative prime to p, then we can put them in some interval y and y plus x, and we see that this interval contains at least k numbers relative prime to all positive integers up to x, or equivalent to all primes up to x. So we see that the rho prime of x is greater than or equal to k. On the other hand, hold on a moment. Okay. On the other hand, let us take k equal to rho star of x. Then by the definition, there is an integer z, and there are numbers given a set of bk such that all numbers are positive integers up to x, and none of these numbers z plus b1 etc. z plus bk is divisible by any prime p up to x. So we see that the condition to check that this sequence is admissible is satisfied for all primes p up to x. But if p is greater than x, then they see that the condition is trivially satisfied because here we have k numbers. K is not greater than x, and so these numbers cannot complete all residue classes for the p if p is greater than x. Yes, okay. And if we assume that the prime Ketepler conjecture holds, then we have this equality. All three quantities are equal. Indeed, it is trivial that the first number doesn't exceed the second number, the second number doesn't exceed Rostov of x. But on the other hand, we have seen that if you have Rostov of x, then we have an admissible sequence of k numbers in the interval from 0 to x, and using the k-tuple conjecture, we see that we can find infinitely many x such that this difference pi of x plus y minus pi of y is equal to Rostov of x, and we have this equality. Also, we will use this notation. Log of x is log of x, log of x is log of x, and so on. Okay. And I have mentioned about the result of Hensley and Richards. What did they prove? That that for large x, rho star of x is actually greater than pi of x. And then we have this asymptotical inequality. It has been checked by Clark and Jervik in 2003 that this inequality holds for x equal to this guy. So we see that assuming the prime k-tuple conjecture, we conclude that that for any large x, this number is positive, and the maximum over all y greater than or equal to x, so on this expression, pi of x plus y minus pi of x minus pi of y, can be estimated from below by this expression. And for example, we would have this inequality. And so this shows that the prime k-tuple conjecture is not compatible with the Hardy-Littlewood conjecture of Hardy and Littlewood. Actually, it's very difficult to disprove the conjecture of Hardy and Littlewood unconditionally. In principle, we could try to find the number y, say for this x is equal to 4916. We can try to find the x such that this difference is big, but it is. If you want to find it by computer, it is a hopeless problem, because we can expect that the least such number y is very, very huge, and there is no way to find it, or only we can try to coach it by random choice, but let me say that from computational point of view, it is a hopeless problem. And now I'll talk about the arguments of Hensley and Richards. What do they suggest? They suggest to consider the following set B. B consists of all plus minus P, where P runs over all primes from some number Y to 1/2 of X. And we assume that X is odd. It's not principal, but if X is odd, then the set B is contained in the interval of X consecutive integers. And we have this equality for the cardinality of the set B. Now I want to compare this guy to pi of 1/2 of X with pi of X. It is a simple asymptotic estimate for the function pi of X. For pi of X, we have this asymptotic equality. And if we plug in X over 2 instead of X, then we have this asymptotics, and after small transformations, we have the following asymptotic expression for pi of X over 2. And so, to pi of X over 2 minus pi of X has the asymptotic estimate, and so I want to show that for some appropriate y, this set y is an admissible set, but also pi of y is small, and to pi of x over 2 is close to the cardinality of the set B. So actually, if y satisfies this supposition, then pi of y is small log of x over log square of x, and from this equality we conclude the following asymptotic equality for the cardinality of B minus pi of x. And now we have to understand why a set B for some appropriate y is an admissible set. And one can show that this holds for this number y for some Poisson constant c. And to show that this set is an admissible set, we can see that if p is less than or equal to y, then by our construction, all elements of B are plus or negative primes greater than y. So no element of the set B is divisible by any p up to y. On the other hand, if p is large, if p is greater than the cardinality of B, then the set B can contain at most the cardinality of B, congruence classes modulo P, and not all the classes modulo P. And the most difficult case is the case when P is between Y and the cardinality of B. And and to consider such primes, we use the classical result of Erdős and Rankine. So Erdős and Rankine, when they proved the existence of big gaps between consecutive primes, they proved the following lemma, the following result: for large positive x and for y satisfying this inequality, there is an integer U such that all these numbers, such that any number from this interval from U plus one to U plus y, so we have capital Y consecutive numbers, and each number from this interval has a prime factor up to X. And now it is known that this is true for slightly larger values of Y, so we can improve we can improve this bound. And it was done several years ago by Kevin Ford, Ben Green, Maynard, Tao, and myself. But this is not essential for our purpose, so this result can slightly increase the size of an admissible set, but it's not essential for us. And now, how to check the condition of admissibility? So we have some number p greater than small y, but p does exceed the cardinality of the set B, and we define capital X and we define capital Y. We can estimate from above the size of capital Y, and we see that this equality holds. And if you take capital C equal to 3 over small c, then for this x and for this y, we can use the result of Erdős and Rankine. Next, we define the capital P. The capital P is the product of all primes up to capital X. And after that, we take an integer V satisfying this congruence condition. You see, V is congruent to U times P modulo capital P. And also, so you can take such a number V in any interval of size P, and in particular, we can take V in this interval. So we have this congruence. So we can this congruence, and so we see that this number is divisible by some prime Q up to X, because U plus G by the result of Erdős and Rankine is divisible by some prime Q up to X. And now we take, what do you want to say? What do you want to show? Want to show that if you have this congruence class modulo P, V modulo P, then any number from this congruence class, from the interval from minus x over 2 to x over 2, any number is divisible by some prime up to x. So we take this number n, n is v plus jp. What is g? What is g? We see v is smaller than 1/2 of x, and if n belongs to these intervals, we see then g must be a positive integer. On the other hand, we can write an upper estimate for g. It is bounded by x plus capital P over small p, and this is, it is at most x over y plus 1 by the choice of capital Y. We see that j is at most capital Y, and but we have proved that for any sub j, this number n plus n is v plus jp is divisible by some prime number q up to x, and you see if n is divisible by q up to x, then n cannot be an element of the set B, because all elements P are primes, plus minus primes. All primes are greater than P. So actually we have checked that our set is an admissible set. But you see that using this condition, using this construction, we get a set B such that its cardinality is bounded by this guy, 2 pi of x over 2. And one more question, maybe it is true that rho star of x is bounded by this guy, or a weak equation, is it true that we have this inequality? And Schinzel offered a construction against these conjectures. Actually, it is not known whether just the construction of Schinzel works. Why does it give an admissible set? But one can use it for numerical experiments, and Gordon Andratemich showed that this inequality doesn't hold for this x. Okay, now let me talk about the construction of Schinzel. What is it?
Sergei, sorry to interrupt you. Igor Spalinsky has a question regarding your previous slides. Igor, can you please mute and ask away?
Okay, yes.
Oh, hi, Sergei. Could you come back to the previous slide, please?
To the previous slide.
Why is v is less than minus x over 2? I wonder if the first line contains a typo.
So v?
Should be minus x, I guess.
Yes. It is a mistake.
Minus x over 2. Okay. Yeah.
It should be
makes sense.
X over 2, yes.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Igor. Yes.
Okay. Thank
you.
So
v belongs from minus x over 2 minus p to minus x over 2. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. And let me return to the construction of Schinzel. Let y is greater than square root of x, and we use the Hartzsprung to the interval one x eliminate the all multiples of the primes p up to y. If I stop here, so this is just the Erdős-Svenus sieve. But we do it for all odd p, all the odd primes p. For odd primes p, but for p equal to 2, we eliminate the congruence class 1 modulo. 1 modulo 2. So we, after the first theorem, we have only even numbers. And we denote the remaining set by u, u depends on y. It is easy to see what what is the structure of the set U. U contains you consists of all numbers 2 to ELF over P. So ELF is a positive integer. P is greater than Y. It is easy to see because any element of U cannot divide by any prime up to Y, so it can be divisible by any prime up to square root of X, because we eliminated all primes up to Y. But if a number doesn't exceed X and all prime factors are greater than square root of X, it must be prime. So P must be prime, and prime and P is multiplied by some power of 2. And now we'll compare the set U of Y. U zero is the set of all such primes up to X, and P is an unrestricted odd prime. And it is easy to estimate the cardinality of the set U0, because for any alpha, the number of primes of the form 2 to alpha times P, it is just this number, and we have to take the sum over all alpha, and it is we can write this in asymptotic formula for P for pi x over 2 to alpha, and after taking the sum, we see that we have this estimate for the cardinality of U0. And the idea was to choose an appropriate number y such that the difference between the sets U0 and U is small. This difference can be estimated by this sum, and we assume this is equal to 9 for y, and it's not so difficult to show that we can estimate the cardinality of this set U0 minus U by this guy. And so we have this inequality provided, or if equivalent, this inequality provided that y is smaller than this guy x, divided by log x and divided by log of x. And so if we take this number y, we have a required estimate for the coordinate of the set U, but is the set admissible? We don't know. Probably is. And moreover, Schinzel suggested the generalization of his construction. So let the M be a small, let the M be a positive integer. We assume that M is small, M is bounded by these guys, square root of log of x. But actually, we think about M as a number tending to infinity as x tends to infinity. And we use again the Hadley-Sewell Ertesfenus, but now we for all primes p1 etc. p sub m, we eliminate the congruence class equal to 1 moduli p sub I instead of 0 moduli pi. And the u is again the residual set. So we again assume this inequality for y. And again, it is easy to understand the structure of the set U. Small u of the set capital U can be divisible by some primes up to P sub m. So we do not test the set of such primes, or the primes up to P sub m divided U by capital R. This set is not empty because any element U must be divisible by 2. And the set S is the complement to the set R in the set of M least primes. And so you know the structure of the set U. And again, if you skip the condition greater than Y, then we can estimate, we can get another set U zero and after some rather long by standard calculations, one can show this asymptotic formula for the set U, for the coordinate of the set U zero. And if you look at this sum tends to infinity if M tends to infinity. And so the coordinate of U zero minus power of x is asymptotically x divided by log x squared, but after that multiplied by some number log m, which tends to infinity. Yes. And now we want to compare the set U zero with the set U, our aim is to have this asymptotic formula for the set U rather than for the set U zero. And it's easy to show that the coordinate of the difference U zero minus U can be estimated from above by this guy. And so we have the required asymptotic formula provided that y satisfies this condition. You see that if you increase the m, this condition becomes a stronger one. So if I specify this condition, we have this inequality. But the question is whether the set U is admissible or not. And probably it is admissible, but now this question looks almost hopeless. So you see that when I was talking about the result of Hensley and Richards, to prove that that set was admissible, I used some local arguments. And here, the local argument should be that for sufficient logic and for this Y, there is an integer U such that each number from this interval has a prime factor up to X. So, we should have the stronger version of or dilemma by Erdős-Renten, but actually we believe that in this form the result doesn't hold, that this is not true if m is greater than 2. So probably it's highly likely that we can't use local arguments to prove that our set is an admissible set, but we don't know how to use other arguments. Yes. And so there is a problem, but we want to overcome this problem. So we want to correct the set constructed by Schinzel, and to prove the following theorem. We have this upper estimate for row star of X minus prefix and the color says that if we assume the K-tuple conjecture, then we have default local estimate for pi of X plus Y minus pi of X minus pi of Y. Okay. So for yes, excuse me. Actually, if you use the arguments of Erdős-Renten, we can prove the following lemma. You see that I'll not prove this lemma, and I'll give only sketch of proof of the rest. Because it's not simple, but as I have mentioned, to prove this lemma, it's enough to use the arguments of Erdős-Renten, and the use of this lemma we prove another lemma. We prove lemma two. What is lemma two? So X and T are positive integers. T is small, it's at most log x over 2. P is a prime between square root of x and x over log x. X is a sufficiently large positive integer. And then we declare the following, that there exists a satisfying the following condition. The number of positive integer n up to x congruent to a mod vp such that all prime divisors of n are either less less than or equal to 2 or greater than square root of x can be estimated by this number. Most numbers n congruent to a modulo p up to x have some prime divisor between p and square root of x. And we will use this property to do the following. So we have a set constructed by Schwinzel. Maybe it's not admissible, but we for any p we assume some numbers from this set belong to some congruent squares module p, and we do it for all for our primes from t to square root of x from all t to some appropriate number, and the idea is to for any p to to remove some numbers from some congruent class in such a way to improve a small number of numbers, and so we in such a way we correct the set constructed by Schwinzel. We remove a few numbers from it, and we get an admissible set. How we prove this lemma? So we use lemma one. We take this capital X and capital Y. And by lemma one, we take some u and the corresponding set n of positive integers starts with such that u plus x has no prime divisors from this interval from t to x. Yes, and this the result of such number n doesn't exceed this guy. This is okay. We use it. Okay.
Just one question, please, from Kevin. Yeah. Kevin, can you please unmute and ask away?
One moment.
Yes, I'm here. The question is about lemma one, the hypotheses on t. Since you're sieving out the interval t comma x, you certainly cannot conclude this if t is close to x or t equals x. So I suppose t must be very small.
Okay. We'll assume that. One moment. Okay, one moment. Okay, actually we need this lemma for t less than a log of x. So you can take here a log of capital X. Okay.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I have to think more about your amount, but we can assume that t is very small because we are using it for very small t is at most a log of x. Okay. So we. And here, okay, we will assume that so t is smaller, so it's less than. Okay, a little bit log of x. Okay. Now we should be we repeat the arguments, I was talking about during the proof of Hensley and Richard's result, we take this number capital Q, and again, I'll take this number A0, and then for any integer j, and for any n from the interval from 1 to y, this number is A0 minus j q plus np has no prime divisors from t to x, only if n belongs to capital N. So for most numbers, then it has prime divisors from this interval. Okay, and now we'll use the arguments of Meyer's matrix method. So we take this number G. G is minimum of these guys. So since Q is essentially at most square root of X, so we have capital G is also close to square root of X. And for any n, the number of g from this interval such that a0 minus j2 plus np has no prime divisors from x to square root of small x can be bounded by this guy. We use simple sieve arguments. And this number is bounded by this number. Okay, and so you see that if you are interested or from the buzzer of this guy in zero minus Jacob plus NP, we have to consider only n from script n. Yes, but for any such n, this number has no prime divisor from t to square root or t to square root of, yes, the number of pairs of nj such that this guy has no prime divisor from t to square root, yes, can be estimated by this number. So this is the cardinality of the set n, and for any number n, the number of j is bounded by this number. And now we use the pigeonhole principle. We can take j so that the number of n such that this number has no prime divisor from t to square root of x is small, is bounded by this guy. And if n, but if n has this form and capital N has this form and capital N is bounded by x, then n has can be represented in this form for some n up to capital Y. And so this actually this proves lemma 2, and we can conclude corollary 2 that if P satisfies this condition, then there is supposed to be integer A is equal to n modulo P, and the n is a positive integer not exceeding x, such that and any such n must have a divisor from capital T to square root of x. So to prove choral two, we use lemma two and we look at the estimate of lemma two. We see that the number of exceptional n, if p satisfies this condition, the number of exceptional n is smaller than one. If this is this number smaller than one, then we see that such numbers n don't exist. And now let me return to the construction of Schinzel. We take the following value for m. So this is y. And then we know then that the set U constructed by Schinzel specifies this asymptotical equality. And so this is about 1/2 minus epsilon times this guy. So we have an extra factor log of x. Log of x. So, by the definition of u, for any prime p up to y, there is some congruence corresponding to p which contains none of elements of u. And now we didn't know what by t this guy p sub n. So p is less than log of square root of log of x, and z is this guy. By corollary two, for any prime greater than z, there exists a from z such that for any n, any such n has a prime divisor from t to square root of x. So this number n cannot belong to the set constructed by Schinzel to the set U. So the condition of admissibility is shown for primes p greater than z. And we have to, yes, but let me say again that we can't check. We don't know how to check the condition of admissibility for the set U for medium prime U, for medium prime P greater than T and less than Z. And now for such P, we use lemma 2 to remove some numbers. For any prime P, we don't know by U P these guys. We can estimate by lemma 2, we can estimate U of P by this guy UP. Actually, we had an extra factor log 4 of x. Log x in the denominator, but we ignore it and we have a different upper estimate. Okay. And we construct a new set U prime is U minus the union of all sets U of P. And for any P, we remove some range of class modulo P. Yes, and the primes in doubt were the primes from this interval, from y to z. I think from t to z, okay, it should be. And yes, yes, from y to z, yes, because if p is less than y, then by our construction, the condition of admissibility holds for y, so the primes and delta primes between y and z, and they removed some numbers. The number of such numbers is bounded by this sum. The sum of UP can be estimated by this guy. It can be done by standard calculations. By the choice of M, we have these inequalities. Here we use that M squared is less than log of x, and we get the required result. Thank you very much.